Good morning and welcome to HCC. It's so good to be together today. Anya and I are back from Poland. We took 11 days out there and it was so good. Celebrated our 25th wedding anniversary. Marriage, long-term relationships, you have got to invest into them. And we just took time talking, walking, had some great meals together. I just think finding each other again was just so good to spend quality time and celebrating what the past has been, but also kind of planning and thinking about the future as well. So thank you for releasing us for that time to go enjoy a great part of the world down in the Tatra Mountains south of Krakow. Highly recommend a visit any time. But this morning we come to the final part of our five-part series we've been looking at over July, at the power of five of the ministries of Jesus that transformed lives. And I guess for us this is one of our most favourite parts today, as we look at the heart of the shepherd and the call upon us as people, individuals, and as the church, to love one another and to care for each other and to bring kindness. So I'm going to hand over now to Helen and a curious guest who's going to introduce today's theme to us. Have a great morning.
Today we're looking at what does it mean to be a shepherd, and we're going to be looking at Jesus being the good shepherd. And so I thought, what a perfect opportunity to nip into the field and look at some sheep. So I'm going to do that now.
You said, you come by.
Right, so
come by, girl. Come by. Whoa. What do you think you was doing?
Well, I'm just going to go into the field to see the sheep.
I don't think so.
We'll just get past you.
I don't think you will. I don't think, because I am standing in this gateway and I am the gate and you shall not pass.
Right.
Me sheepdog. Wait, you do, get by, girl, get by, come by, good girl.
But we just want to go and look at the sheep.
I don't think so, because I'm standing in this gateway, so the sheep can't escape apart from this little cheeky little one, which I managed to catch, and you can't get in. No one can get in. I am the gate, and I take care of my sheep. Besides, you won't get close to them. No, won't get close to them. They only know my voice.
Could you call them over?
Come by, girl, me and my sheepdog. Good girl.
Could you call the sheep over?
I'll get my dogs to do it. Go get. Round up. Go round. Round and back. No, not today.
Okay. I just wondered if the sheep know your voice, if you could maybe call them. I mean, do you just call sheep, or are they individually named?
Come here. Go over. No, I think you're busy.
Busy. So you stand there to make sure nothing can get in and out of
right.
the field, and your sheep stay safe.
That's right.
Well, okay, I think that's a little bit like what it says in John about Jesus stands in the gate to protect us, and he would lay down his life for us. I think it says that in the Bible. But I'm just wondering, I just actually can't see any sheep in that field. Well, apart from that one, but if you look in the field...
You stay there, don't you come in. I'm watching you. Oh no. Oh fiddle it. We got the wrong field, dogs. Come on. We got the wrong. They're in the next field. Hip hip. Come hither. Come by.
Well, that got rid of him, but I guess there's no point going through the gate now because there's no sheep there. So today we're thinking about what does it mean to be a shepherd. Now Jesus showed what it meant to be a shepherd by saying that he cared so much about his sheep, and we're his sheep, that he knows us by name, that he wants to protect us, that he's going to look after us, that he wants to keep the flock together because that's how it's safest. And we're thinking about a story he told as well about a shepherd who had 100 sheep. Now one day he counted them and found out that one was missing, so he left the 99 safe and went to find the one that was missing. Because a shepherd is somebody who cares about people when they're struggling, when they need help, when they need encouraging. And our sheet is exploring that story. There's a game of hide and sheep, where somebody has to go and hide and the shepherd has to find them. There's a story to watch. And then there's also a few things to make. You can make your very own 3D sheep like this. And in the top here, so I'll just have to pop those there. In the top here, You need to think about what things you can do to show you care. And I've written some in on bits of paper, which I've put in there. And this one says, play a game with somebody who might be a bit bored at home. Or we've got, clear the table after a meal. Leave a friendly note, hide a friendly note for someone that where they'll find it. And we've got little activities we can do there that we can make a difference by just showing we care. And we're also wanting to think about, you can cut this out and make this, think about people in our life who care for us and who look after us and who encourage us. And you can write their names on the back there. I've put thank you Jesus for, and then I've listed people that have encouraged and helped me in my life. And we're thinking about that. So, and there's also a maze to do too, to remind us that Jesus is always looking for us. He always wants to be with us. And that's what we're discussing today, about what does it mean to be a shepherd, and remembering that we've got the best example in Jesus.
Beautiful one I love, beautiful.
powerful metaphors we see in Scripture is the relationship between God and people, being like the relationship between a caring and a purposeful shepherd and his sheep, which he cares for and guides and protects. We're going to be unpacking this more this morning, but I wonder how you have felt cared for over this time. One of the things I love about Jesus, and we're reading about how he was with people in it from the Gospels, is he wasn't interested about celebrity mass campaigns. Although he did attract crowds, one of the most powerful things we see when we read and discover Jesus is that he cared about individuals, that people deeply mattered to him, and individuals matter to God. God loves everyone. He loves you, he loves me, he loves people. That's what he does. This relationship is what he is about. And Jesus came to start relationships and to make reconnections. And I'd love to read, before we break for 5 minutes, Matthew chapter 18 and verse 11. So it says, "For the Son of Man," that's Jesus, "has come to save that which was lost. What do you think? If a man has 100 sheep and one of them goes astray, does he not leave the 99 and go to the mountains to seek the one that is straying? And if he found, and if he should find it, assuredly I say to you, he rejoices more over that sheep than over the 99 that did not stray. Even so, is it not the will of your Father who is in heaven that not one of these little ones should perish?" God's heart is massive towards us. He loves you today. He is for us. And this is the heart of the shepherd, who wants to care, who wants to walk with us, who has drawn us into relationship with him. And so we're going to take a couple of moments now, as we have done each week, to connect with someone over a text. And maybe this morning we could just take a moment to thank someone who encouraged us over this time. Someone who we've been blessed by, who has looked out for us and encouraged us during this time. Just to thank them for their care towards us at this time. Let's take 5. Welcome back. I can't believe we have been doing 16 Sundays online. And, you know, at this point, just as we're coming to the end of term, schools breaking up, the holiday season starting, I just want to say a really huge thanks to everyone who's participated in any of our Sunday online services, from, you know, contributing stories, testimonies, prayers, the musicians who have collaborated with their musical gifts. And particularly want to give thanks and recognition and a shout out to Trevor and Richard, who have spent hours in editing behind the scenes and I think have brought us something really fantastic. Also, just love Richard Schweer and Helen Cobby's weekly all-age updates, and to Anya and to Helen for the family sheets that get posted out every single Sunday with all that dynamic learning. And I really hope that over these weeks we have been able to engage with the scripture, with learning together and growing together in quite a different way. But I've loved hearing different voices, different stories, and I just want that to be part of what we're going forward on, that this isn't just about one or two people. This is about all of us engaging together, and we've all got something to contribute. And that's, of course, what we've been thinking about over these particular last 5 weeks, thinking about the power of five, where we've been thinking about the gifts that Jesus has placed in each and every one of us to build one another up, to express the fullness of Jesus. And as we go forward, as we move forward, as we begin to think about what does society look like, what does community look like, we need each of these five ministries and mindsets and contributions all flowing to shape the mission and the heart and the sense of family and God-connected community that Jesus desires us to be. And we can be activating these not only in our church life and family life, but also in our workspaces. Man, we need these giftings at play right across society. And these are gifts that Jesus has given. Remember, we've been thinking about the role of the apostolic, the prophetic, the evangelistic, the teacher, and the shepherding role is what we're going to be thinking about today. So thank you for journeying with us. And in particular, want to thank Stephen Corley, who's actually put a huge amount of work into thinking about this afresh with some of his writing, leading the deep dives each Thursday, which I've found really inspiring and helpful. And also weekly, just unpacking a bit, what do these ministry flow gifts look like? And so this week, as you've already gained and picked up, we are looking at the fifth role of the shepherd. And we've picked up the heart of God and the heart of Jesus, that he was an incredible shepherd. Well, let's join Stephen now for the next couple of minutes, thinking about the shepherding role that you can experience in your life, both here in church, but perhaps also in your workplace. Let's just take a moment.
Good morning. Today in our journey through the Ephesians 4 APS Ministries, we come to shepherding. It's a challenge to write about the shepherd pastor because we're all so familiar with this gifting, perhaps over-familiar even. The pastor is the catch-all job title of the church in the West. In this definition of pastor, they are spiritual leaders, business visionaries, heads of staff, health managers, communication experts, hirers and fires, and everything else. In reality, by this definition, they look more like a CEO rather than an integral spoke on the wheel of kingdom transformation. This view of the pastor as CEO has changed the missional body of Christ into Church Inc. Limited PLC. In Ephesians 4:11, in the original Greek, Paul doesn't mention pastors, but shepherds. And the word he uses is shepherd, as in actual shepherds, the people who look after sheep. Pastors, what we get after the Greek is translated into Latin and then translated into English. Shepherds are called and equipped to jump into the messiness of life without a hazmat suit. They don't run from crises, they jump right in. They get into the middle of things where it's most uncomfortable and bring light into a situation, a quiet light. They don't avoid or ignore emotion, they embrace it. Where the tears flow, that's where the shepherd goes. They understand that life is messy, but aren't put off. When someone is at their worst, shepherds are at their best. This shouldn't be a surprise after all. Jesus is the ultimate shepherd, and he entered into life. Life is what Jesus died to save. Life is what Jesus conquered death to set free. So Jesus gave the shepherding impulse to act as our guides, the joy and pain, and through the laughter and sorrow that are all part of life. Shepherds are like heart mechanics. They get under the bonnet and listen, waiting to hear from the problem. Let's take a look at a clip from one of my favourite TV shows, NCIS, which I think demonstrates beautifully shepherding functioning in the workplace.
Don't you have work to do? Look, it's not something that you can fix in the classic Gibbs hit-and-run style, okay?
I got time, Abs.
It's stupid. It's just a guy. I'm not gonna start spilling my guts just because you keep standing here. All right, apparently I am too much for him. Can you imagine that? Me? And it's not what you think. It's not all this. He likes small women. I got dumped because I'm too big. And don't even bother with the, no, with him, he's too small, or if he can't accept you for who you are, then it's his problem thing. He just doesn't think that we could make it work, and I've done everything I can to try to convince him that he's wrong. So I guess I'm just gonna have to accept it. And let it go. Thanks, Gibbs. You always know what to say.
For those who don't know the show, Gibbs is the boss and continually shepherds his team. In this scene, he made space for Abby to be herself. She has the room to hurt, to be vulnerable, and to be embraced by his being present and listening. I'd like to turn now to the shepherding function within the community of the church. It has a clearly defined purpose, and I've identified 10 elements I'd like to share. First, it's to enrich the communal experience. At its core, the church is a community gathered around and joined to Jesus. A community made up of those who have been saved, reconciled, and healed by grace. There are meaningful relationships with one another and a strong value for each person's story. The ability to build friendship, mutuality, reconciliation and devotion all exemplify the shepherding function's role in creating and maintaining a healthy community. Second, to develop social bonding. The shepherding function develops the necessary attachment and bonding to the Jesus movement, the mission and its purposes in the world. They focus on developing loving relationships in the world that mirror the love of Jesus. Three, to demonstrate a credible witness. The shepherding purpose of the church is to nurture an alternative society based on a willingness to live by the power of the gospel and witnessing to the blessings of God's kingdom in a local and global context. In John 13:35, it's clear that one of the main ways the world will know us is by a reputation as a loving and accepting community. Four, to protect the body. Healthy communities are very difficult to develop and maintain. Because each member of the community is capable of sinful actions, and each community is made up of selfish people, community life is vulnerable to damage. Shepherding serves to protect the church from influences and people that will destroy it from inside out. And at all times, needs to be able to identify, correct, and discipline errant body members. Five, to promote and facilitate healing. The shepherding function covers everything from the practical care of the sick and weak to prayer for healing to counselling and reconciliation and broken relationships, a vital part of healthy community. Six, to encourage shalom and wholeness. The biblical concept of peace, that is shalom, involves not just an absence of conflict or strife, but also an active experience of harmony, restoring of wholeness, and the experience of godly prosperity. The shepherding individual is key to this process. 7. To champion inclusion. The members of the church are chosen by Jesus. The church is the new humanity, made up of all classes, ethnicities and genders, united together in Jesus and called his body. The shepherd is often the glue, along with the Holy Spirit, that holds this diversity together. 8. To assist in discipleship. Shepherding individuals help church members to live consistent lives in the everyday. The local church is a disciple-making system where everyone is committed to following Jesus. 9. To enable human flourishing. The shepherding function creates a culture and an environment where people can thrive and flourish and reach their full potential as creatures made in the image of God. And 10. To cultivate the family of God. One of the main goals of the shepherding function is to draw people together and reconcile them together as a redeemed family. Shepherding looks to restore God to the people as Father and to each other as brothers and sisters. So what do you think? What has your experience of the shepherding function been? Do these 10 elements help you recognise your own shepherding calling? I'd love to hear your thoughts.
I love that, Stephen. I love how Gibbs, in the role of the boss he plays with his team, just continually shepherds. And in that scene, obviously gave Abby just space to be herself. He created a space for her to her and just to be vulnerable, to be embraced by him, just being present and listening. And sometimes that's the role of the pastor. And I'd love you to be able to listen to Stephen's fuller thoughts on actually how does this look like, not just being pastoral in our workplace, but how does this look like being pastoral and the shepherding role within God's family, within the church. So watch that before this next Thursday's deep dive when we're going to be unpacking the role some more. But we're going to be now catching up in an interview that Stephen undertook with a friend of HCC's from the past, someone who was a pastor within HCC a number of years ago, Nigel Double. And Stephen catches up with Nigel now to unpack what does it look like to be a pastor within God's family. And this could be something that God is drawing you to, that you just find yourself being drawn to care and to guide people and to support people. And Nigel brings out four things in his interview, which I think are really timely for us to think about.
So good morning and welcome to Nigel Double, who I have with us this morning. Nigel, many in HCC may not know who you are. They may have heard the name. Would you just take a few minutes and tell us a bit about you and what you're up to?
Hi, Stephen. Hi, everybody out there. What a funny season we're in, but hopefully we're coming through slowly. I've either been involved in print or preparation for print on the mission field in Tanzania for a few years, then pastoring and leading churches for another good period of my time. And then in 1997, I felt a call of God to get involved in the parliamentary scene, not as a politician, but as a pastor. And so I've spent the last 20 years full time working within that context with members of parliament, one in particular, but a number of members of parliament across the political spectrum. And that brings me up to the.
And for many years, you and your wife Barbara were with us at HCC. How long ago was it? How long were you with us? And how long ago was it you moved on?
It just
seems... Okay, well, we came in, we moved up in 87 to join Simon, who was leading the church then. And originally we were planted in Ramsey and intended to do something specifically there. But as time went on, that sort of became a part of HCC. And so that was 87. I started working as the associate pastor there in 94. And I left in the last day of 2001.
Wow.
We actually moved in 2002 March. So we've been gone a long time.
You have, yeah, go. It just seems like yesterday you and Barbara and all of us were together at the PAC and enjoying life there.
Yes, well, there you go. It must have seemed like a century when we were there. And you see, now we've gone, you know how much you miss us.
Yeah,
but we're only up the road in Peterborough, aren't we?
Yeah, that's right. You're just up the road. So look, Nigel, it sounds like you got lots of experience over the years of sort of that shepherding function, that shepherding role. I mean, if I were to ask you to put it into a nutshell, what would you describe that shepherding gift as?
This will be a big nutshell, I think.
It's fine.
Because, it's what I call the essence of shepherding. Let me just begin by telling a quick short story. It's about a little boy, a little boy who was frightened of the dark. And so his mummy took him up to bed and she came down and he shouted down and he said, "Mummy, I'm afraid of the dark. Come up." And so mummy said, "I don't need to come up. God is with you." So he then waited a few moments and then he said, Daddy, please come up because I'm frightened. I need you up here." And Daddy shouted up the stairs, "It's okay. God is with you." And so his reply to that was, after a little while, "One of you get up here now. I need someone with skin on." And to me, that's the essence of what we're talking about when we talk about shepherding or caring for people. Very often, the philosophical part of it is that, well, God is the answer to all our needs. But sometimes other people need skin on in order to be able to move forward, move on, move out, get free from some of these other things. Of course, God is still the essence. God is still the main part. But he has to use other people to do that. Male, female, young, old. So as far as I'm concerned, it's about care. So shepherding is about caring. It's about the care we provide for other people. And I would split that into four different functions, saying it's about confidential conversation. Mm-hmm. So there's confidence in that you're listening and you're hearing and you're sharing, and it won't be trawled around for anyone else to hear. That's vital. Secondly, it's about accessible, always being available and accountable. So you're accountable to one another. There has to be availability all the time. You can't just shut people in and shut people out, whether you're on the receiving end of shepherding or whether you're on the giving end of shepherding, because it's a two-way thing.
Sure.
And you both need to be open with each other and accessible. So, you can't have a pastor and I will mix pastor and shepherd quite a lot. You can't have a pastor who you really never know or never get to see or get to talk to. Someone somewhere, you will need someone somewhere. We can't exist as individuals. The third thing, which is reliable representation. The person who is pastoring or shepherding has to give an accurate representation of the God that we're talking about. And it's important that they know that, and the recipient knows that, that it's true to the Lord. Otherwise, we get taken off in funny and daft directions that actually don't do us any good. And lastly, it's of the four letters, it's encouraging encounters. So there has to be encouragement within it, but there will be encounters. And I use the word encounters very carefully there. I thought about using the word confrontation, and but actually it is confrontation. Confrontation is care. But how it is done is very important. Sometimes it has to be done firmly, but it needs to be an encouragement. So it's all about building and availability and confidentiality and true representation of the God that we love and serve.
Jack, that's really helpful, Nigel. I mean, I've just realised as you were going through that, it spells care. I mean, obviously it's what you were aiming at, but that's a really easy thing, I think, for us all to remember in terms of what the essence is of shepherding. So thank you for spelling that out. I mean, obviously, in these days, as you mentioned, we're in really strange times, and we're hopefully coming through them, and we don't know what the future will look like in terms of, will it be back to normal, or is there a new normal, or, you know, we hear it all. How important do you think the whole shepherding function is going to be going forward? And accepting you don't know what the future will look like, but in your experience, what do you think?
Well, from my point of view, I was born a shepherd. I was born to pastor. You never quite know what life is about until you get into your later teens. But I would say, you know, from the age of 17 or 18, it's been evident to me that my life has been about caring for other people. And it just, to me, it just happens naturally. And it's just such a natural part of life to give. It's not always as easy to receive it, but to give it, that actually I can't envisage life without it. And of course, obviously going forward, we're going to have people coming out of all sorts of situations where they've had to face all sorts of circumstances. Some of them will be very positive experiences. You know, will we ever want to get on a train again? you don't have to anymore. I haven't had to do it regularly for a long time, but I can imagine a lot of people out there will be in a position now where they want to change their lives. They want to do something different, and if their employer won't permit that, then they will need help. And that is where the pastor comes in. That's where the person aside encourages them either to a new job or a new way of working, or perhaps building discipline. Because working from home isn't always easy, is it?
So, look, Nigel, you said something really interesting there that struck me. You know, you were saying from about the age of, 16, 17, you became aware. Can you, for those who may be sitting there thinking, is this me? Am I, you know, have I got the shepherding calling? Can you maybe describe for us some of the, what was it that made you aware that this was your calling?
I think it just really sort of comes out of an having an awareness of people. Okay. And actually seeing beyond the mask, the front of what people show you, never really being satisfied with what you're being shown by the person, but actually having an insight and a discernment into the what's going on behind. And you know, for many years, I've walked into shops and have people behind the counter tell me their life story, and I've gone to buy a bar of chocolate or something, and you think, why me? Well, obviously, there's something on me that makes them want to talk to me about it, but it's also being able to represent something to other people. And I find whether people are Christians, see, within the context of the church, there is an expectation that this might go on. But out in the world at large, you don't always find that. And so actually, but everybody needs it.
Mm.
And so they're always on the lookout, although they don't know that. It's one of those hidden needs that you don't really understand or know. And so I think you just have to go about and be who you are and be ready to recognize that people fascinate you.
Yeah.
People inspire something in you to respond to. And, you know, it won't always be brilliant and good. In fact, very often the stories are sad and traumatic.
Mm.
And so there needs to be a big heart in there somewhere.
Mm.
The heart of God in you is bigger than your heart will ever be.
Sure.
And that's what they've got to find, the heart of God in you.
Yeah, and it comes back to that, as you were saying, that reliable representation. You touched briefly there on sort of how this operates outside of the church, and I'd love to hear, you know, and I recognise you can't share a lot of detail given the nature of some of the work you are doing, but it'd be great, I think, for us to hear a bit about how this operates outside of the church in your experience, and specifically in your work in Parliament.
Mm. Yeah, well, it has been, as I said, I went in the pastoral sense as a pastor, because having felt the call and made a connection with my local MP, who was at the time the now deceased lovely Lord Marwini, I met an old associate of mine called Gary Streeter, now Sir Gary Streeter, you know, he represented to me the need that parliamentarians have, because they're individuals who come away from their home, away from their lives, for great periods of each year, and they're thrown into an unnatural situation where there are lots of temptations, and there are lots of trials, and there's lots of anguish, where one person's trying to get better of another, and usually on their own side, in order to get up the ladder. And so that's how I began. And so I began to see and to meet with different individuals who I was invited to, and then some younger men who were not members of Parliament yet, and I had the privilege of being a pastor to them before they became elected. So I've done the complete spectrum in many respects, and I have been out politically on the doors with certain individuals as they try to make their calling full, and so I have, you know, a wealth of experience that I would never have had. I would never have been a politician. I would never have knocked on a door.
Mm.
But don't get me wrong, I am not a politician. I am not political in the sense that I hold to one party or one view, and I can see something wrong in them all.
Mm-hmm.
Number of members of Parliament across the parties, all males in the main, but what I tend to do is not just be a pastor. I tend to be able to offer other skills like administration, IT knowledge. So it, you know, even sort of flat maintenance. I've done this pastor has done a range of jobs that most shepherds would not do on sheep. But I love it. I haven't done so much pastoring the last 5 years because, as you know, I've been trapped in my own home quite a lot because of an excess of involvement through my life and having fatigue. So, but I still maintain interest and involvement.
Yeah. Well, yeah. You know, now that we've all discovered Zoom, you know, that we can do, we can pattern connect from wherever we are.
The last 4 or 5 months have been a complete joy. I've gone to some meetings I haven't been to in years.
Yeah, me too. I mean, Nick, Nigel, I mean, that's been fascinating, and we could go on forever, I'm sure, just sharing. But, you know, if there was one thing you'd want people who are listening to this or watching this to sort of take away from all of that, what would that one thing be? I know that's hard to nail it down, but, you know, I'm sure there's one thing you'd love for us to hear.
Will you let me have two or not?
Okay, two. I just like Desert Island Discs.
I'll give you two and you can cut one if you want. The most important thing is a scripture, which is from Colossians 1, 28 and 29. We proclaim him, admonishing every man and teaching every man in all wisdom, that we may present every man perfect,
yes,
in Christ Jesus,
yes,
for which I also labor, striving according to the working which works in me mightily.
Wow, yeah.
And, you know, it's that perfection, that completion, that maturity that is behind the motivation of why you do this.
Mm-hmm.
And the second thing is about just being, you know, don't think we need to be special. Being ordinary is what it takes.
Really powerful. Look, Nigel, thank you so much for your time this morning, and thank you for leaving us with, I think, those really inspiring words that will encourage us all to just think about how do we serve just as ordinary people.
Thank you. Bless you.
Thank you.
Nigel, so great to catch up with you, and thank you for sharing your thoughts with us today. And we support Nigel financially as a church monthly, just sowing into his ministry, supporting and shepherding, pastoring MPs, Christian MPs down in Westminster. And it's been a privilege over the last couple of years for myself to be able to engage with him in some of that work and seeing the work that he continues to do. And it is very, very meaningful and is contributing to the shape of our country in many quiet, silent ways. So Nigel, we love and support you. I love this heart of God that's just coming through, and I'm reminded by Psalm 77 where the psalmist reflects on how God led Israel out of captivity. God is for our freedom. He is for our growth, as we've heard from Nigel just in these last couple of moments. And the psalmist in chapter 77 and verse 9 reflects, your road led Israel through the sea, your pathway through the mighty waters, a pathway no one knew was there. You led your people along that road like a flock of sheep, with Moses and Aaron as their shepherds. And I love that picture of God doing the miraculous, of opening the waters, of making a way where there seems to be no way. But as Nigel said, sometimes we need God in skin. And how even with Israel, God had set in Moses and Aaron as shepherds to walk through with them through the valley and through the challenge times. And, you know, I just want to encourage us at this time to think, who does God want me to walk alongside, to be the heart of God for? And also to thank God for those that he has placed with us. And it may be that today, in today's service, you've joined us and you're like, do you know what? I just feel isolated. I feel kind of a bit lost. And God today wants to invite you home to become part of his family, where he wants to save you, to embrace you, to give your life a start and a purpose. He loves you. He is committed to us as people. And he died on a cross to take away our sin, our fallen shortness, our brokenness. He took a cross. And Jesus dealt with us that we might come back into fullness of life and a relationship with a living God. And that God is reaching out to you today. And so if you just want to give your life to Jesus today, to say, God, I want you to be my guide. I want you to lead me through uncertain times. Then right now, we can pray together and you can pray this prayer to invite God into your heart. Dear Lord Jesus, I come to you today and confess that I need you. Please come into my life and forgive me for all my sins. Jesus, be my Lord and be my Saviour. Thank you for giving me a brand new start. Today I open up my life to you, and I am now your child. Amen. So as we come to the close of our morning, I've come out to Anya's greenhouse where she is growing some incredible tomatoes and really enjoying the gardens at the moment. And I don't know what you do to replenish and to regenerate and to kind of revive, but over August, as we look now forward to the summer, we are going to be dialing down a little to think about how we can recharge ourselves afresh in God. Something that I think so often we get really strived out in life about, trying to live for God, trying to obey God, trying to do all the right things. And do you know what? The posture that we have been designed for is not to live under God or for God or try and take what we can get from God just to do our own survive through life. But more than anything, you have been designed to walk with God, designed for a relationship, to commune with him, to walk with him, to celebrate him, to know him, to worship him. And out of that place, we then do life. And so what we're going to be doing over August is we're going to be taking a shorter time each week at 10 o'clock to reflect on Psalm 23 in a series that's simply called Led. And it's where God wants to lead you into rest, into a place of refreshing, where he wants to lead us actually through the valleys and through some of the challenging stuff, where he wants to guide us along right paths in our lives, and ultimately how he wants to lead us into his presence. So each week we're going to be having a short talk, a song of worship, and a meditation with some scripture reading, so we can just regenerate and revive. And then out of that, at 12:30, for any that are able to, on the Sunday the 2nd, so next Sunday, and then Sunday the 16th, and then Sunday the 30th, we're going to be looking at how can we begin to regather in a physical space as well as an online space. And so we're going to be gathering for a distance picnics over those 3 days down at the park, Riverside Park, off the Huntingdon Ring Road, where we're going to be gathering on the left-hand side on the field area down by the river for just distance fellowship. Bring your chair, bring your packed lunch, and we'll be just having a time to reconnect together. So really want to encourage you for those times over this time. And also whether this week we can be praying for the Summer Brunch Project. We have launched it this week. It started last Wednesday, where 36 families that will really benefit from social contact and the opportunity for a meal every day are being served in partnership with the local council and five of us as churches, where we're coming together. I just want to thank you for all of those of you that are volunteering part of that project, and we're really excited because at the end of the day, God's called us to love our community and not just to be a shepherd and to be pastoral to one another, but to love the communities in which God's placed us. And so practically, that's what we're doing this summer. So please pray for that this week, and we'll be great. So I'm going to hand over now to Jean, who's going to pray for us and to close our time together.
Thank you for joining us today. And if you would like to deep dive further into today's subject, you can join us on Thursday evening at 8 o'clock. If this was your first time with us and you would like to keep in touch, please press the connect button. And if you want to give into HCC, you can do this by using the online button during our closing song, which is My Guardian, after which you're welcome to join us on a Zoom call. I pray that you may all have a blessed week, knowing that God is your guardian. And then remember a picnic next week at the Riverside Park.
Where your kingdom come, your will be done. All your promises will stand forever. You're my defender. You go before me. You're the peace I
for your love to us. Thank you that you love each one of us and that your love, Lord, never fails. And I just pray, Father, for each one of us that, Lord, we would be that church family, those people, Lord, that show others your love by loving them, by caring for them, by being a family together. Thank you, Lord, that you've called us into one big family, your family. And I pray, Lord, that as living this out, we will show others your love towards them, the love that Jesus showed to us by dying for us. Thank you for your great love. No love is much any greater than yours. And thank you that love reaches each one of us. Amen.